Hey, part four of Channel 5's spoiler. I'd forgotten about the split cards, so you get this fourth part, and we'll reflect a little bit back on the set. These split cards are cool. Now, they all have the new keyword fuse, which probably won't be repeated, which means that you can cast one or both halves from your hand. Now, I've not read any FAQs, but all of these cards are worded such that if you cast the one on the left, then the one on the right, they do better effects. So I'm imagining that's how the order that they'll resolve in. Now, the name's pretty good. There's a few poker terms in there, which I quite like. Let's get to works. Alive and well. One half of it is a hill giant. This is good. We know this is good. The other half of it is a congregate, or gains two life for each creature you control. So neither bit of that is really exciting enough to get it into constructed. However, we're not going to say no to a hill giant in limited, and a hill giant with a built-in potential for mass life. Awesome. So yeah, good limited, unlikely constructed, but not the end of the world. Armed and dangerous. Target creature gets +1/+1 and double strike. Important to note, sorcery. The other half, all creatures able to block target guy do so. So it's just not, neither part's great. It's really a six mana spell that says get all your other guys through and probably kill a couple of their, some if not all their creatures. And that is a fairly powerful effect for limited. I mean, it gets spoiled by cards like Smite or any instant removal spell. But yeah, this is definitely a gruel card. It's very unlikely you kind of wanted in a deck without the ability to fuse it. Beck and Call. The Beck part is a one mana glimpse of the nature that triggers not just when you cast them, but when they enter the battlefield. So that works for token creatures. So it's just nice to have this card back in circulation, because there might be some cool combo decks out there that could utilize it. Call, on the other hand, then limited. Six mana for sometimes a constructed, if for any of those people who remember playing Migration Call. Back in Invasion Block. The ability to put 4/1/1 flying tokens into play is like a Lingering Souls, one might say. So not really powerful enough to impact Constructed. Having said that, for 8 mana you do get to put 4/1/1s into play and draw 4 cards. So it'd be cool in Banth if you get to do that kind of stuff. Not in Constructed, because you'd just rather cast Sphinx's Revelation, or have Sphinx's Revelation in your deck. But yeah, in Limited. Interesting card. Breaking and Entering. So this is the Grixis Fuse Rare. Now what's this do? So it's Glimpse the Unthinkable, but a little worse for 8 cards in one half. So not very good, as we know, but sometimes enabler of dredge or reanimation strategies in times gone by. And put a creature card from a graveyard, so yours or theirs, and it has haste. So 6 mana to reanimate something from either. Again, by itself, not powerful enough to play in Constructed. 8 mana, not really powerful enough to play in Constructed. But if you are playing some kind of reanimated deck, then for this half, then it's kind of a free splash of red to really gain the ability of the other half. So kind of cool, not too great. Catch and Release. Can't remember what color combination this is called. So the first bit is a threaten, but it's a permanent threaten like Zealous Conscripts. And as we know, that's quite good because you can take Planeswalkers and ultimate them. And threatens have perennially been quite good, you know, when you get Titans or just random abilities like that. The other half of the effect is genuinely powerful. Very kind of white effect. Each player sacrifices one of each permanent type, artifact, creature, enchantment. Oh, yeah, artifact, enchantment, creature, land, and planeswalker. Unlikely to have more than one planeswalker, so it's going to be quite a good way of killing those. Now, obviously, if you somehow have 9 mana and get to fuse it, you get to sacrifice whatever it is that you nick for a little bit of additional impact. But yeah, this half of it really might see some niche play. Down and Dirty, the first of our poker terms, often referring to the seventh card or final card in a stud game. 4 mana target player discards 2 cards. We've all played this in Limited. We might again. It's not great. It's not the end of the world. Return target card from your grave to your hand. Recollect. Strictly better than Recollect over here. Well, I can think of a few instances where it's not, if you get voided for four, for example. But for the most part, it's better. So in limited, both these cards are borderline playable. If you're both colors, then the flexibility means you're probably going to, yeah, it will definitely increase, but they're still both late game cards. And the fact that for seven mana, you can, yeah, they probably won't get, you probably get one card out of their hand, that's turn seven, and one card for graveyard. That's still pretty cool. So it's just a weak limited card that has potential. Not really constructed, but Recollect might be. Far and away. Okay, here we go. Here's a good card. So for two mana, it's an unsummon. Two mana instant unsummon. That's not the end of the world. It's not as cheap or efficient, but it means that on the two drop we get to remove a creature if we want. Then on the three drop we get to edict them. Now these cards work in tandem. We can bounce a guy on turn two, untap and edict them with the if we have two of them in our hand. Alternatively, turn five we get to, well, for those of you who remember Jilt, kind of Jilt, we get to do both. So we get to bounce their smaller guy and edict their bigger guy. That's very, very powerful because it's great on two mana, great on three mana, and phenomenal on five mana. I love this card. Flesh and Blood. The first half, exile target creature card from a graveyard. Not a good start. Put X target pounds on target creature, where X is the power of exile. So it's a kind of remove a guy from the bin, kind of pump a card for way too much mana. Not a good effect. Blood, two mana. Target creature you control deals damage equal to its power to target creature or player. So just the one half of a fight that does players as well for two mana. It is a sorcery, but this part is good. Yeah, it's a combo. So if you get to set, like, seven mana is not unheard of. So you're going to be, this is one of those cards that you'll play for the blood. And if you get a black splash in your deck and you get to that much mana, you're going to really get to use it. So, yeah, I mean, blood's good enough. Give and Take, not a fan of this card. Three mana, put three, so that's fine. Pump a guy, sorcery. Not a constructed card, but limited, cool. Remove all plus one counters for target creature control, draw that many cards. I don't understand this because you don't, well, I do get it, it's just not powerful. So you're not going to really want to do that because it's not an instant. So you're just going to make a guy that is on the board doing stuff, being really big, smaller. So maybe if they pacify it, I don't know. Or for six mana, you get to draw three cards. Yay! I mean, I'm going to play that because I like doing that kind of thing. But it's not super powerful and it's not constructed. Profit and Loss, good name. Your guys get bigger, their guys get smaller. Cheap enough to fuse. This ability is not really good enough constructed. This one sometimes is. So, unlikely to be constructed, but could. Limited, on the other hand. Yeah, it's that was a card that did this called Zealous something or other. Zealous Conscription? Inscription? Can't remember. Either way, fine. Limited, unlikely constructed. Protect and Serve. Target guy gets defensively pumped for quite a bit of mana. Or target creature gets shrunk for a little bit of mana. Ability for multiple card advantage and limited for five. But hard situations for it to set up. Never going to be constructed playable. Flexible enough to see limited, quite a lot of limited play because both halves are efficient. Ready and Willing, bit sexual, I know. So what have we got here? Creatures you control are indestructible. Untap them all. So good because this is Wrath, the Supreme Verdict defense. And you can surprise your opponent by untapping everything, so that's going to be good in both limited and possibly constructed. The other half, creatures you control can gain Death Touch and Lifelink. So we already know that this is one bit of an Azorius charm that we sometimes use. It's straight up an activation of Vault of the Archangel, and together for 5 mana, all our guys are indestructible, untapped, Death Touched, and Lifelink. So in creature kind of matchups, that's going to be fairly swingy. And if we're attacking on our turn, we might well have 5 mana. If our opponent kills a guy, we get to make it indestructible and get some value out of it. So I like this card. We're going to be playing it in limited almost for certainly. And not unlikely and constructed, could be a cyber card against Wraths. Toil and Trouble, nice little Macbeth reference. Target player draws 2 cards, loses 2 life, so 3 mana Night's Whisper. That can target them. We're fine with that in black. Greed at any cost, remember? Greatness at any cost, my apologies, Bob. Trouble. deals damage to target player equal to the number of cards in their hand. So for a finisher, yeah, this is going to deal them at least 4 damage and give them 2 cards. As a general sideboard card against control decks, it's okay. Not great. More of a Night's Whisper with some flexibility. Turn and Burn. I'm not sure whether this is going to be a poker reference or a Top Gun reference. Either way, I'm happy. Again, this is a burn card. This card is for the burn. So, shock. 2 mana shock. No complaints. The ability to, if we can get a block in there as well, to take out a big or any kind of creature for 3 mana off the turn part is solid. And the fact that we can, for 5 mana, we can kill any creature, or possibly get 2-for-1s means that, yes, this is a slam in limited because it's a flexible shop with more power, I can definitely see this playing, seeing constructed, but it's kind of, is it charm power level? And as we've seen, that hasn't seen too much play. So not as significant, let's say, as Far and Away. Wear and Tear, another one of my favorite cards in the set. It is a Shatter and essentially an Erase put together and cheaply. So this is a disenchant for all intents and purposes, depending on which color you are, or both. And if you're both, there is the rare chance that you can get card advantage out of it. Again, at instant speed, cheaply. This card is one of my favorite cards in the set. That brings us to the end of the split cards. Now, the artifacts are all identical. They're all 3 mana, 1 from each guild, tap for both colors of that guild, with the ability of pay both mana that's associated with, sacrifice it, draw a card. So they are accelerant fixes. They can be used the turn they come into play, and in the late game you can sacrifice them to draw some stuff once the mana's not too relevant. How good are they? Unlikely to be constructed playable, but from time to time formats have forced us to stoop to it, especially in block. I don't know how accelerant or color fixing looks in block, but might well see some play there. And in limited, not phenomenal. The fact that they do draw a card means that you're going to be okay, and the format's normally quite fast, but if we have enough stuff to accelerate into or mana to fix, then we're going to like it. They're not great, they're not bad. Now the land, now as we know, there are all the guild gates and all the dual lands. Now, I'm not here to talk about the impact that this has on dual land prices, but they're already not too expensive, and it's just nice to have them all because you basically need 40 dual lands to have a good deck building collection from anyway. Apologies for the cutoff there, had to let the old fiance in. And the one special land in this set, Maze's End. So, enters the battlefield tapped. Taps for colorless mana, but it gives us the ability to Thawing Glacier gates into play, with the added value of winning the game if we control 10 or more gates with different names. 10 or more gates with different names. Oh, of course, one of each gate. Sorry, I was doing some math incorrectly there. So, I mean, someone's going to try and play a deck which has one of each gate and one or two Maze's Ends, because you don't have to play win conditions. But having said that, that might be most decks these days have incremental win conditions. So like your Planeswalkers that you play to keep you alive turn, like Tamiyo, turn into a win condition. So I don't think it's going to be a deck. I hope it is, but it's cool if it isn't. Okay,